Now, Michael, you were actually surprised to win this project. Can you tell us why?
There's a couple of reasons. I've just finished doing a competition in Brisbane that took 48 hours. It was a wonderful thing because it gets over and done with. This took 9 months. It went from 64 original entrants to a competition where they chose 8, then they had another competition and they chose 3, and then they had another competition and they chose 1. So by the end of it, there's the war of attrition major thing, you know.
Wow.
More interestingly than that, they also gave feedback to the competitors once they got past the 8. So you went back for about 10 sessions, of full day sessions, to be told what wasn't liked about your design. So that made it somewhat more confusing in a way. And everyone got to see each other's scheme once you got to that point too, which meant we all knew what was happening with everyone. So winning was not sort of, I guess, surprising someone had to win, but it was a kind of tough gig. And you couldn't help thinking by giving that feedback, the schemes would come together in some unison. In fact, they actually didn't, which was interesting. They were vastly different, as it turned out. And I suppose this lastly, in a funny kind of way, perhaps it's just me, but there was a kind of sense we got that there was a club of Starchitects, and who was this little firm from Brisbane crashing our party? But obviously we managed to.
So you talk about this museum as a place of 5 pieces rather than an object. And for those of us who did go to architecture school, we often hear about the Robert Venturi duck. That is, you know, the building that's the object. Why is what you've done so different in China? And why was this accepted as the design solution for the project?
I really think this project is a really seminal one. I think there's some 100 museums apparently being built in China. I think, honestly, there's a tendency that museums will be kind of icons that will badge your brand cities, as perhaps we've talked about. But if you build 100 of them, I think this project made people realise that if every city's got an icon, there's no longer an icon. They're all the same. So the long process was really good in enabling us to put a case forward that experience is more important than a kind of pure visual appreciation. And that the icon was all about enduring building that that did engage its community, gave people very different experiences, and wasn't just a kind of one-hit wonder. So the 5 parts that we created was actually partly a response to a functional series of complex requirements. As Jason said in there, it was an 80,000 square metre building. There are 5 different themes. But by parting the building into those themes, or you not only gave them identity, you engaged each with the water, which seems like a really obvious thing to do with a maritime museum, but with an object, those schemes didn't tend to do that. Secondly, it articulated the building into something that actually has a human scale instead of being just a hugely impressive one. Thirdly, it related it to a park that's you saw in the video that's next door to it, so we really wanted to get the building to come out of its environment rather than be dumped on it. But we had to argue for all of those things pretty heavily. There was very different kinds of judges. There was a central government set of judges. There was a local bureaucracy set of judges. There was a bunch of heads of the major universities all around China. And there were the Maritime Museum people. And sorry, there was the contractor who was going to build it. They all had different thoughts, or I wouldn't say agendas, but different perceptions of what this project was about. So the 9 months actually gave you an ability to actually argue what are we really doing. And we actually, I think I'd say the other two that made the final 3, even though someone won in the end, all felt they were actually working on the project in the end, not just doing a competition. And the project was about contemplating where's China going and what's the building meant to be doing.
Now, this museum is also anticipated to play a really significant role in the future of Shenzhen, and that's a city of 20 million people. And it's a city that you've talked about as physically shifting. You know, how can a building actually, you know, what role can it play in actually shifting the city?
It was a strange thing when you go to cities. We hadn't been to Tianjin before. If you drive through Tianjin, despite having that number of people, there seem to be lots of tracts of land that aren't developed because it's had an agricultural past to it. And here they were actually reclaiming water to build this building, which didn't seem to be necessary. So it was very hard to understand what that kind of morphology was, but they did realise that the great cities of the world are actually water cities. And whether it's Venice stepping into the water, the character often comes out of its relationship to the water, Sydney particularly. So the idea was to kind of shift urbanity away from the sort of cheap agricultural lands where development had happened previously to the waterfront, and then try and do it in a way that made this city different than other cities around the world. And what they liked about our scheme was, and I mentioned Venice, it kind of steps in the water and then suffers sea rising problems. This building cantilevers out over the water and kind of gets people to hover above it. Not only is that just a sea level thing, but it creates a different set of engagements altogether. So that's how we're able to argue that if we could do that, as I hope you saw in the scheme, we could also make this the kind of community heart of Tianjin in future, not just the international thing that internationals came to and left behind. And that's why we also started to see if we could ask if we could develop around the building back into the city, and that fishing village, which is also a fishing markets, there's a massive, you know, fishing industry there. If you relate it to the museum, gives an economy to the building, but ingrains it within the city as well.
Yeah, and I think that point that, you know, this building does draw very much from its context. It is very connected to local place. You know, it's not, you know, plonkitecture, an object that's just landed. You know, what are the sort of the local attributes and aspects of culture that we can see reflected in the building?
Part of that is the culture of the city. It's actually a city that has a somewhat declining economy, and economy and culture can't be parted. So we thought the building could give confidence to the people of Tianjin. And one of those ways, as you saw there, was really exploring how we could use local crafts in the making of the building. As it happened, as you saw, it's three-dimensional two different directions, very three-dimensional. It was pretty obvious that boat building, for instance, is a classic way of dealing with those kind of geometries. Then we started to investigate other artistry within Tianjin, ceramics being one of those. Then we went and said, hang on, we've done this white building. What about this pollution? In fact, we started to think the only buildings that actually kind of look good in Tianjin are with parapets, because the smog just sits down somewhere behind the parapet wall and you don't see it, and we're clean. And we thought, we've done these kind of amorphous shapes and it's white, and gee, I wonder how this looks. It was actually fascinating that by working with that ceramic layering, we've worked out a way where we think the roofs can be completely self-cleaning. So without being able to use their skills or their knowledge, I think you'd run that risk, like here or anywhere else, of an international coming in, putting a building in that's got certain attributes but hasn't understood all of the conditions. But culturally, that's how that community and city's embraced this project, and it is no longer seen, like all the other museums, as far as I know, as being central government run and sort of being imposed there. It's actually growing out of the community.